Okay, welcome. Sorry for the lack of a break, but it looks like there was improvisation anyway. We're now moving into the second panel, Neighborhood Inequality and the Concentration of Social Dislocations. And I'm Rob Sampson, a professor of sociology here at Harvard, and I'm delighted to chair the session. I've been colleagues with Bill for a number of years here at Harvard, but also at the University of Chicago. Moved there in 1991, I think it was. And just before that, when I read The Truly Disadvantaged, it was like, I'm sure for other people, a bit like a bolt of lightning in the sense of how it reframed a lot of what I was thinking about in terms of the study of the city and particularly urban neighborhoods. So what I'd like to do in introducing the panelists, just briefly talk a bit about the idea of neighborhood effects, because I think it's fair to argue that if you take Truly Disadvantaged, the notion of concentration effects is one of the core ideas in the book, and Bill says as much. And it's not just about a single factor, such as poverty, but rather a constellation of factors within the inner city that he was talking about. In other words, the idea of concentration effects, but also social dislocations in terms of a number of phenomena, such as poverty, unemployment, female-headed families, poor health, are some of the things that Bill talks about in the very beginning of the book. And it also led to the notion that that meant that there was a unique experience of African Americans in the inner city. It wasn't just about poverty, but it was the intersection of race and poverty. Bill talked about the mechanisms of neighborhood change in terms of the out-migration of the middle class, and he also linked neighborhoods to the wider social transformations that were going on in U.S. society. And this is talked about, of course, in the first panel in part. So it's really bringing together those ideas, but fundamentally, the notion of neighborhood inequality, neighborhood effects, runs throughout the book. And the study of neighborhood effects actually has a long history. It goes back, depending on how we want to think about it, to Victorian England, early Chicago school. But Bill really led, I think, to a resurgence in that area. And my own work was affected. And what I'd like to do is just to talk for 5 minutes or so about a couple of the key themes and updating some of the ideas. The notion of concentration effects still exists. Bill's book was published in 1987. Really, the data kind of go through the 80s. Since the 80s, we've seen profound transformations in the city. Immigration, changing economy again, decline, booms. We've seen a great crime decline. But yet, across this period, concentration of social phenomena, in this case murder, or hotspots of crime, the dark areas are per capita rates. Low birth weight babies. This kind of goes right to the first chapter of Bill's book, right? It's not just one thing. You really probably can't tell that much of a difference. Some areas are almost unscathed, as it were. Other areas are deeply affected by these social dislocations. Now, that's a comparison, a point in time, but it's also important, I think, and a lot of my own work has looked at the relationship over time, and particularly what I've called poverty traps or the durability of concentrated poverty traps. If you think about it, Bill was focusing mainly on the 1960 to 70, 70 to 80 period of the transformation of the economy and deindustrialization. Again, since 1980, a lot has happened. This, in a way, bookends it. From 1960 poverty all the way to 2000. And what you see, and for social science data, it's rather remarkable, quite a strong correlation. The poorest neighborhood in 1960, Chicago, still the poorest neighborhood. Sort of a churning effect. People are moving in and out. There are not the same people in these neighborhoods. Tremendous mobility, yet a reproduction of its essential position in the class hierarchy at the level of neighborhoods. In other words, the stratification, the relative stability, the pecking order, however you want to think about it, is remarkably stable over long periods of time. It's not just Chicago. This is actually every single census tract in the United States, correlation of 0.85 in both Chicago and the U.S. During the 90 to 2000 period when we, quote, ended welfare as we know it. Welfare dependence is a key indicator in the Truly Disadvantaged. Again, high degree of stability, it's not just poverty. I think this is another remarkable phenomenon. You all know that there's been a, quote, great crime decline, tremendous drop in crime in the United States. That's sort of the superimposed red arrow going down. But you see the lines for both robbery and homicide, almost unity. That is to say, high-risk neighborhoods in terms of violence are very, very persistent and remain persistently at risk, even as a large-scale social phenomenon is being superimposed over it. I think in social science, we tend to conflate or confuse these things. And I bring it up because Bill's book is about social transformation, both of neighborhoods and of the macro economy. And what I've tried to do is to, in part, integrate these two. They don't contradict one another. They work together. And in this case, neighborhoods are remaining, in a sense, in these kind of traps of recycling of great disadvantage, even through the Great Recession. We don't have census data yet, or at least good census data for 2010, but what we're able to do is to get housing data from CHA. And this is a chart that shows concentrated disadvantage index, poverty, female-headed families, unemployment, the sort of the stuff of the truly disadvantaged, and an indicator of poverty from low-income housing on the left axis, and then obtain foreclosure data. Now that's part of the national economy. It's part of the collapse of the Great Recession. But of course, it's not random. The foreclosures are being imposed on a set of neighborhoods that were disadvantaged, that remain disadvantaged, and even through the Great Recession, we see this persistence, tenacious hold. I think of these, when I teach this, I call them Bill Wilson's neighborhoods. Sorry, Bill. Only in the sense that these are the neighborhoods that he talks about, named and truly disadvantaged. Places like Englewood, Garfield Park, Grand Boulevard. These are at-risk neighborhoods, but you can see what's happening. The rich get richer, the poor get poorer, even at the neighborhood level. There is change, don't get me wrong, and I study this. But what happens is the neighborhoods that change are largely through large-scale structural interventions. It's not just a natural process. And what this means, particularly for children and particularly for race, is that black children and white children are growing up in very different worlds. This is based on a longitudinal study in Chicago. And the black lines on the right actually trace where people moved by the concentrated disadvantage in the neighborhood. The white sample is not as large. I could blow it up and weight it to make it equal, but this is just the raw data. And basically what you see is that white families, and therefore the exposure of children to concentrated disadvantage, is almost non-existent. In fact, it is. And it's moving within quadrants of the city. So it's not even just about the neighborhood. It's really about spatial regimes of inequality. And black children and their families are moving within very restricted areas, and this, I think, has effects. And in a recent book, I've tried to look at this with regard to learning, with regard to crime, with regard to health, and a number of other things. And just to give you a point before concluding on the magnitude of this, and this was an analysis with Pat Charkey and Steve Rowdenbush, where we set out to look at the effects of concentrated disadvantage over the long run on learning patterns for whites, Latinos, and blacks. Turned out we could not even estimate the effect for Latinos even, or whites. Why? This is the table. If you look at the concentrated disadvantage and you simply take the bottom quartile, about a third, just under a third of African-American children live in severe concentrated disadvantage poverty. 0% whites, 0%. Latinos, handful. And this, again, is through time. Well, what does that mean? There's no proper comparison. I like to think of these as sort of phantom counterfactuals. There, you know, you can run regressions out there and estimate the effects on whites, but actually it's meaningless within these data because of the structural constraints. And I think that's a powerful factor. So what I've tried to do in my recent book is to put this all together. And the reason I mentioned the sort of macroeconomy at the beginning is that if you think about it, one of the fundamental insights, or at least I would argue, of Wilson's truly disadvantaged was to recognize how the social organization of local communities, especially in the segregated ghettos, was deeply intertwined with large-scale economic changes in the case of the social transformation of the economy. But, as I've shown, this goes through to include other social transformations, such as immigration, such as the crime boom, the crime drop, the boom in the economy, and then the collapse. Now, what's important, though, I think, is to say that some have read Wilson's argument to say that neighborhood effects are misspecified as a result of such outside forces, to which today we can add further globalization and rapid increases in international migration. Such forces matter, but they do not negate what I would call the, quote, lower order mechanisms of neighborhood effects any more than individuals are impotent in any setting. Secular change, in other words, and macroeconomic forces are, in essence, interacting with these other levels. You can think of the neighborhood, at least I do, and hence the graph here, is sort of a mediator, but that is integrally linked. So that individual choice, I don't deny at all. And in fact, if you look at truly disadvantaged, one of the mechanisms of neighborhood change in the truly disadvantaged was out-migration. That's an individual choice. Constraints are limited, hence the relationship to the higher order structures. But then that changes the neighborhood composition. But then the neighborhood composition changes individual choice. Individual residential choice, in my work, clearly is related to the neighborhood characteristics, but then that is changing even the higher order structures. Now, higher order structures is a complex construct. I'm not going to get into it today. Part of what I do is to try to build on Bill's work and move into looking at links, not just that is within neighborhood effects, but effects throughout the social structure of the city and the metropolitan region. But I think it's important to think about how individual characteristics are deeply rooted in structural effects, and particularly cognition. And I see individual cognition and choice as really a substrate of macro inequality. So the project, the intellectual project, I think, of neighborhood effects research, in my view, is not to deny individual choice. It's not to say that the macro somehow overwhelms everything, but rather to try to integrate it. But one can't do everything. So my own work has tried to drill down, if you will, particularly in the neighborhood effects. And I'll just end there, but I would like to say that if you think about the effect of the truly disadvantaged, I think it's important to keep this kind of larger structural view in mind. And this is actually a quote. This is something I wrote in the book, I think it was, that I reread yesterday, and I believe even more, which is that if you reread Truly Disadvantaged, it really is a book that has deep insights, talks about social isolation, but I think it really is a structuralist argument that has been, in a sense, misinterpreted at the level of policy. And I'll just leave that there. And we can't have discussion right now. I'm sorry. We have to. I've got my instructions. I have to move on and introduce the rest of the panel. But we will have time for discussion. So hold your questions. So we've got a stellar lineup here, and I'm not going to go through just like myself. Just quick introductions. Jeanne Brooks-Gunn is a long-term scholar. Developmental psychology, neighborhood effects, Columbia University, and she's going to speak next.
Thanks, Rob, and especially thank you to Bill. Like many people, although I would frame this a little bit differently, reading The Truly Disadvantaged did change my life. As a lifespan developmental psychologist, I may be the only one in the room who's a developmental psychologist, I would say that reading The Truly Disadvantaged really was a turning point in my life, because I had been studying children And I had been thinking about change, but change over the life course, rather than looking at transformation of families or of neighborhoods. And so I would say that my research totally changed from that point. Although, interestingly, at the moment, I want to make one comment at the end about how some of my earlier work is now coming back and can actually help inform what's going on in neighborhood research, which is kind of exciting. People, again, who study the lifespan love it when things all come together, right? In some way. So I'm interested, really, in how families and individuals are embedded in neighborhoods and how family life and neighborhoods intersect. I think sometimes my research is seen, I'm thinking of just what Rob put up, as focusing much more on individuals than the structural parts. I hope to convince you that developmental psychologists are trying to take structural factors into account and look at dislocations. So what I want to do is talk about several aspects of this transformation, or what you see in highly concentrated poverty neighborhoods, in terms of how families are being affected. And the way I'm seeing it these days is that we're looking at the dislocation and reproduction of neighborhoods in terms of uncertainty in the lives of families. And I want to talk about several kinds of uncertainties that are being studied at the moment. Dig down on how the social psychological processes of neighborhoods, or the structural parts, get transmitted to kids and then continue to go through generations of families who are, if you will, trapped in poor neighborhoods. The first example I want to give is just instability in households. We certainly have thought a lot about instability and residential instability, and at the same time, the fact that you may be entrapped in a poor neighborhood, you may be cycling through poor neighborhoods, but you're not escaping, if you will, poor neighborhoods. But I want you to think about that also in terms of what's happening to the child within the household and within the school system. So I am one of the people that runs Fragile Families, which is a 20-city study started by Sarah McClanahan. We have 5,000 families. It's a birth cohort. And our kids are about to turn 15, and we're about to go back into the field. What's important is we oversampled unwed mothers. We saw the children and the mothers and fathers when the babies were born in the hospital. This is a magic moment when you can get mothers to talk to you, and all of the dads come to see the babies. So we are kind of the only longitudinal study, I believe, in existence that has followed the fathers for 15 years, as well as mothers. And again, we've oversampled unwed. We're in 20 cities, and of course, we have overrepresented in our sample, given the composition, families that live in concentrated, highly concentrated poor neighborhoods. So when we look at our unwed families, you find that by the time our kids are age 5, over a third of them have had 5 to 6 transitions of men moving in and out of the house. I'm not talking about neighborhoods, right? We have those analyses too, but just look within the household. Only a handful have had no transitions. So when I'm talking about instability, people talk about residential instability, but within these neighborhoods, you're talking about a lot of cycling of people in and out of households. These effects seem to be more predictive of child outcomes than actual family structure. Okay, that's something that most people don't realize, but that's what we're finding. And the second point is people have got to start studying much more as these dads or fathers or men are cycling in and out of the household, where are they living the other times? And what does that mean for their life trajectories, that they're all cycling in and out of what you might see as a more or less stable unit of mothers and children? Huge issue that people really haven't looked at that's related to the structural unemployment issues, at least in my opinion. Second point would be school cycling for children. In many of the neighborhoods that we're talking about, over 50% of the kids are new every year in the school. This kind of instability in terms of peer networks and education and teaching are just phenomenal. If you want to look at the achievement gap, as many of us do, one thing that people have started to look at is the instability within schools, where you see the largest contribution, if you will, to achievement gaps. Because as most of you know, the achievement gaps that you see at age five, I study a lot of little kids, are not diminished by the advent of school. In fact, if anything, they get larger. And there are a lot of things we can look at it in schools, but the instability is one that I think we ought to be looking at. That gives a lot of uncertainty to children. My last example really is the fact that, let's go to biological fathers, because when we study children, we care about biological dads. We have just finished an analysis looking at the timing of the biological father's exit from the household. Remember, about half of all unwed families, the dads are cohabiting when the baby's born. Okay, so they're in the house. So we did an analysis looking at when, because I really care about what parts of the life course are most likely to influence children's trajectories. But we also found out there were quite a few fathers that moved back into the house. So we were able to look at exits and entrances. And in fact, we found negative effects of the exits and positive effects on children of the fathers re-entering the household. These are the biological fathers, right? This is net of all the transition of people moving in and out, which really is making us now think about instability and what the biological father means to the child in a very different way. One thing we're probably not going to talk about too much here today is the gendered nature of at least child rearing. We are talking about the gendered nature of unemployment for black males. And I should mention that these effects are only found for the boys. And these are in terms of aggressive behavior. And they're also in terms of pro-social behavior, just in the opposite direction, right? The dad moving in increases pro-social, decreases aggression, and then vice versa. But I want us to think, when we talk about the problems that men, young men, have in highly concentrated poverty neighborhoods, we start needing to look at what the life of children is like, especially young boys, because these gender differences are popping up all over the place for those of us who study families in poor neighborhoods. My second example is uncertainty from an economic standpoint and how that may affect families and children. And the example I want to give is a paper we've just finished with Fragile Families. At age nine, when we were in the field, the Great Recession happened. And we've been doing a lot of analyses looking at changes in the unemployment rate, the foreclosure rate, and the consumer confidence or sentiment index. And at the moment, I'm looking at harsh parenting. I'm looking at how this affects parents, as well as how much time they're spending with kids and activities. And we're finding in our sample that the confidence survey, the consumer sentiment index, is changes in it are predicting more harsh parenting. You get bigger effects for boys, mothers who have boys, excuse me. Although we're finding equal differences among our ethnic groups. But this is just a new stream of research trying to understand, if you will, dislocation at the aggregate level. I'm not looking at individual families' unemployment here. I'm looking at aggregate numbers for unemployment rate. And I'm particularly struck by the confidence index mattering more than the unemployment rate, and what that means for the whole idea of uncertainty in families' lives. Something I think we need to look at much more carefully, and I think it's probably particularly pronounced in our high poverty neighborhoods. We haven't done those analyses yet. My next example is housing. And we talked about this last night, so I'm not going to say much about it, except that I'm doing some work on housing in 15 buildings in New York City. New York City is, this is subsidized housing, not for the very poor, but for the near poor, because New York City is building 165,000 units of subsidized housing during the Bloomberg administration. At least we hope they're going to. And we're doing a randomized trial. In part of it, we're looking at actually how the families who are moving into these buildings define their neighborhoods, where they're actually shopping, and a much more kind of in-depth look at what the patterns of neighborhood use might be in different groups in New York City. My final example, and then I'm out of time, has to do with what I call the long reach of childhood, or how poverty gets under the skin. A lot of psychologists study this. And I really want to reframe this into how neighborhoods get under the skin. And an example, we have a study of 1,000 kids from age 2 to 8, and we've gotten blood pressure on our children. And then we've looked at growth curve trajectories, i.e. which kids are showing, if you will, increases in blood pressure, which we would like to not see, of course, over time. And we find the biggest increases are in our black subsample. And then when we go in to explain that, it's explained by the neighborhood, not by family poverty. So here's an example, and there aren't many that are longitudinal, of the fact that being in a highly concentrated poor neighborhood is actually influencing the blood pressure of children, particularly blacks. But then again, as Rob showed in our sample, like everyone's, there are more blacks in the concentrated poverty neighborhoods than there are the whites. But that would be an example of getting under the skin. And finally, many of us, we're doing this in fragile family, are starting to study epigenetics. And that's going to also show us how neighborhood poverty gets under the skin. What we are finding, for those of you who aren't totally into epigenetics, as I am at the moment, because it really shows how the environment affects the body in ways that nobody really thought was possible until the last 5 years. That environmental events and highly neighborhood concentrated poverty, toxic environments should make a difference, seem to upregulate and downregulate lots of genes. It may be as many as, well, nobody's quite sure. I was just at a meeting at NIA. Maybe 50% of the genes are up and down regulated, maybe smaller. But the up and down regulation seems to be occurring, at least the research now, in three areas: immune system, inflammation, and depression, anxiety. And when I think about, like, my kids with the high blood pressure, you know, if I'd had epigenetic data on them, I don't. My guess is that what we would also be seeing is that families in these types of neighborhoods, and again, this is not a family poverty, it's really a neighborhood effect, are going to be showing more regulation problems in terms of depression, anxiety, that's A, more inflammation, upregulation, and more downregulation of the immune system. My guess is this is probably occurring in childhood, which is why I want to really focus on the long reach of childhood within neighborhoods in a way that we haven't done before. So thank you, Bill.
Thank you, Jeanne. Our next presenter is Larry Katz, our own Larry Katz from Harvard University. Larry is an economist and studies many different things, but one of the hats he wears is the principal investigator of the influential moving to opportunity experiment.
Okay, well, I'm delighted and honored to speak, and I'll take a couple minutes, hopefully, before my official time to say a couple words about Bill, because I, as among many here, found the reading of The Truly Disadvantaged when I was a young assistant professor to be a profound, mind-blowing experience. And I actually want to show one thing. Let's see. Okay. This actually I found. So after I read Bill's book in 1987, I actually switched what I was teaching from an undergraduate class in basic labor economics to a class I called Social Problems of the American Economy, in which the students, economics students at Harvard undergraduates, read Bill's book and things like Sandy Jenks' work, Doug Massey, and Denton. And this was my attempt in 1988, 24 years ago, to lead a discussion on Bill's book and distill it in the reductionist form that an economist, which I think I called a grand theory of social hysteresis for the 1970s. Now, this was not a PowerPoint slide in 1987. It was on a transparency. I did turn it into a PowerPoint slide. So essentially, I don't think this is too awful a job. Basically, and it's going to lead into what I'm going to talk about, neighborhoods, that, you know, Bill's story was one of an adverse macro shock that we today call sort of skill bias, technological change, deindustrialization. Barry Bluestone and Bennett Harrison's work really led into it, led to decline in employment opportunities, particularly for African-American males, less educated, which generated, you know, large problems, you know, particularly the spatial reallocation of employment, of declining, you know, male employment, which fed into what we'll hear later today, changes in family structure, the marriageable male hypothesis, led into basically changing conditions in inner city concentrated poverty areas as the middle class moved out, some of the potential unintended consequences of civil rights and others, which then led to the growing geographic isolation of the poor. And finally, where we're going to come in this session, that then reinforces itself through neighborhood effects and changes in who you interact with, and something at that time economists were calling hysteresis and the persistence of unemployment. And Bill was basically telling a social story for that. And that then leads me thinking about what actually happened from this period in terms of measures of how poverty became concentrated in cities and central cities. And this is from the official poverty numbers, which have all their shortcomings. If you went back to the first year we did it 50 years ago in 1959, poverty in America was disproportionately rural. That's when people like JFK were looking at places in the, you know, in West Virginia and stuff. And central city was below the national poverty rate. Fast forward to when Bill was writing in the 1980s, you know, sort of mid in 73, Central City, we'd done a tremendous job of reducing poverty in non-metro areas and elderly poverty. But as you can see, poverty rates are now highest in the Central City. And in fact, the latest numbers show Paul was talking about 20% tracts as being ones you might think of as concentrated poverty. Well, that's the average poverty rate in the U.S. central cities today. So it was 18% in 1959. You know, you can fudge with these data. The poverty numbers don't include a bunch of things that are important, but I think the relative change suggests we do have a huge problem in U.S. central cities. And one other thing to point out, Bill was talking about this sort of movement out of the middle class and the growing social isolation. You can't actually, while Paul has done a wonderful job, Jargowski is showing us the concentrated poverty numbers, and those are a good index. The fraction that end up in above a 40% or 30 or 20 depends a lot on the levels. And you can also try to look at an index of how much sorting there is by economic status across neighborhoods. And this is an attempt from Sean Reardon and Bischoff, using the latest data from the censuses and the American Community Survey. And what it shows, this is basically an index of how likely or unlikely it is if you're, say, in the bottom fifth of the income distribution to be living with someone who's above you versus being concentrated. And this line going up basically says we're seeing more segregation. Rich people are less likely to have middle-class neighbors. Middle-class neighbors are less likely to have rich or poor. And that's true for all types of American families, but if you look, the one where it's really gone up the most is for black families in the U.S. There's been almost a doubling in this metric. So while it's true that some of the numbers Paul was showing show you that concentration poverty, when you use a cutoff like 40%, may have gone up proportionally more for whites, in fact, Bill's story is much larger for African Americans. If you do the pure sorting, how different are your neighbors? So you had substantial integration. Black neighborhoods were actually more economically integrated in 1970 than white neighborhoods, and now they are much less integrated and much more isolated. So there's a large change in economic segregation. Over the same period, racial segregation of neighborhoods remains extremely high, but has actually gone down as you've seen more mixed neighborhoods, but economic segregation has been rising. Mm-hmm. And so big question are, what are the pure consequences of changes in economic segregation and the neighborhood you grow up and live in for a set of social, economic, and health outcomes? And that leads me to what I want to talk a little bit about. As Rob mentioned, well, most of my time I spend thinking about structural explanations for inequality and supply and demand of different labor, and book I wrote with Claudia Golden called Race Between Education and Technology, really about the first part of Bill's grand theory. I spent a lot of time in recent years trying to analyze a large-scale social experiment to get at least some of the mechanisms behind neighborhood effects, and that's what's known as moving to opportunity. And this has been a big effort with a lot of collaborators. And here is a list. I should note Jens Ludwig at Chicago has been a big player in the long run one. And Lisa Sanbonmatsu, a PhD from Kennedy School, has been tremendous in all aspects of this. So what is moving to opportunity? It was motivated, and I was actually at the meetings in the Clinton administration early 93 when this was being set up as an experiment. And everyone was talking about Bill Wilson's work at that time and the truly disadvantaged. The proximate cause was actually the Rodney King LA riots of 1992, which for a brief moment led Congress to pass an urban bill in which they actually had money for demonstration projects, for innovative ways for trying to change housing mobility in inner city neighborhoods. So motivation, high racial segregation, growing economic segregation, how important are those for the well-being of families? And huge social science literature showing that children who grow up in more disadvantaged neighborhoods, whether we measure them by total disadvantage indices of ROB or poverty, do worse on a wide range of outcomes. Adults living in such neighborhoods have worse health, are more involved in crime. How much of that is a social spillover of the neighborhood environment itself versus something that even if you desegregated people, broader economic and social forces would still play out? If you have low skills and poor job opportunities, is that the driving force, or is it reinforced by your neighborhood environment? That's the type of things that this, and one worries that in sort of market economies, people don't end up randomly living in different places. People tend to use their money to, if you have a lot of money, you want to buy neighborhood amenities and safety and different types of neighbors. And are we just picking up sorting of economic opportunity that wouldn't be offset by changing the neighborhood distribution? So what did moving to opportunity do? It actually, as I said, it was set up by a 1992 act following the Rodney King LA riots. It was a large-scale randomized social experiment operating in five cities, Baltimore, Boston, Chicago, LA, and New York. You had to be living in a concentrated poverty area, a census tract with over a 40% poverty rate, and a public housing project. So this, think about places like this are actually, these are the starting baseline neighborhoods in Chicago. Many of these units have been destroyed since that period. 4,600 families were enrolled, about 900 per site over the next 4 years. We did advertising at these units, and so you should think of people living in public housing units who wanted to move, who had their acts sufficiently together that they would show up and do this intake survey and try to jump the queue to get a housing voucher. So what was the experiment? It allowed people living in project-based housing to basically, in one case, what we call the experimental, to get a regular housing voucher, but also to get help in moving, mobility counseling, and a restriction that they had to move to an, in quote, low poverty area, and another group who got a standard Section 8 voucher. And we have been following these families for the next, now 15 to 17 years. Who are they? Who lived in high poverty public housing in the inner city? Basically, they are largely African-American and Hispanic single female headed households. They were quite poor, largely on public assistance, and that's changed. And the typical family lived in a census tract with a 53% poverty rate in 1990. So this is three standard deviations above the national average, very distressed areas. And why did they want to move? They largely talked about violence and crime, not economic opportunity. There's a lot has been written about it, the interim one. Many people have called this a weak treatment, and we will look at this. Some have argued the interim findings were some impacts on health and mental health, very little on
economic outcomes, some signs that girls really benefited from these moves. What I want to talk about now is the longer range one, outcomes, and basically what I want to show you, this is a snippet of sort of the neighborhoods that the families moved to, and this is the type of experiences in terms of neighborhoods they face over the next 10 to 15 years, which is at baseline, all the experimental and Section 8 and control group all lived on average in 53% poverty areas. 1 year out, the experimental group was on average living 17 percentage points lower. That's what that ITT is. If you actually moved with a voucher, you were now sort of 35, massive change. You went from the bottom 5% worst neighborhoods in the US in terms of measures of distress to basically being at like the median neighborhood in the United States at the time. And over time, the gaps between these groups narrow, but after year two or so, most of that's not the experimental group moving out of their nicer neighborhoods. It's the control group over time getting out of, you know, their units being demolished or they're voluntarily moving. But it's still a substantial, over 15 years, basically if you moved with an MTO voucher, if you could tell me ex ante that you would have taken, you know, several thousand low-income families living in public housing, and half of them you randomly gave that yellow line. That's the distribution of average neighborhood poverty in the neighborhoods they lived in the last 15 years. Well, the experimental people who moved basically were living between 10 and 20% poverty. The U.S. poverty rate's 15% today. They're sort of living at the 40th, 45th percentile of neighborhoods in the U.S. on measures of distress. The control group, some of them eventually escape. Essentially, none of them ever end up in low poverty areas. They're still living, you know, and typically in high distress poverty areas. So what does that do over, and you know, every measure you want to do of safety, of who your neighbors are, of housing problems sort of improve. But the one other thing that's key is you can move with a housing voucher at the US level into much safer neighborhoods, into neighborhoods with very different neighbors in terms of their educational attainment and their employment, but you actually can't move with the amount of money you have in a Section 8 housing choice voucher in the U.S. to neighborhoods that give you access to much better schools in these large U.S. cities. That's the other important thing. So they're changing sort of from the bottom fifth percentile to the middle of the distribution of neighborhood poverty or income, but they're only changing schools from sort of the 15th to the 20th percentile. That's because schools are deteriorating in the edge neighborhoods they can move to in the suburbs, and because there's a lot of choice going on, so the schools do not change nearly as much as the neighborhoods. And what did it mean, very briefly? There are profound effects on health of changing neighborhood environments, something that Jeanne talked about. 1 year out, 5 years out, and 15 years out, substantial improvements in mental health. Large improvements in physical health, obesity. This is the best diet there is being in a low stress area. We're reducing extreme obesity by huge amounts that are, you know, would be clinically valuable. Large reductions in indicators of stress with actual biomarkers, you know, taking blood pricks and looking at things like C-reactive protein. Large reductions in untreated diabetes, which is a huge issue. So a lot of things that will indicate both the adults and for the girls in particular, among the young ones, huge mental health impacts. So if we think of this as moving to tranquility rather than moving to opportunity, it's a huge win. And any benefit-cost analysis done 1 minute on sort of the value of reduced depression, improved health, show that reducing the concentration of poverty has massive impacts on health that are very important and were not sort of the things that were the focus. But what does that translate into economically? I think this graph pretty much says it all. We take these three groups, we follow them over the next 15 years, and we look at their employment outcomes, and basically they lie on each other's lines. So we can greatly affect people's health and well-being through neighborhood changes within the broader context of a very weak labor market. But changing economic and educational outcomes require much more interventions that directly look at the broader macroeconomy and its skills. And we do know, just to conclude, other experimental analyses looking at things like what happens if you get a better teacher, end up going to a better school, the best job training programs for these same populations, changing incentives to work, that those sorts of policies really can have persistent effects on education and employment, and that we're, you know, changes in neighborhood segregation are profoundly important for individual well-being, but by themselves, reducing that isn't going to change the long-term poverty problems, and we need to work on more margins than that.
Thanks, Larry. Our next presenter is Mario Small, who is a professor of sociology at the University of Chicago. He's also, very young age, dean of social sciences at the University of Chicago. We can also claim him a bit as one of our own because he's a graduate of Harvard Sociology Department.
Thank you. Thank you very much. If I can take my pre-speech 1 minute thank you to Bill. When I came to graduate school here, actually what I first wanted to do was not urban social science. I wanted to be a sociologist of knowledge. And in the sociology of knowledge, one of the biggest, most influential classics was Thomas Kuhn's The Structure of Scientific Revolutions, which introduced the idea of a paradigm shift. And a paradigm shift is something that happens often as a result of a major seminal book or a set of papers or scientific studies that forces everybody to ask a completely different set of questions. And it's very clear, at least to me, that that's what really the true disadvantage was. After the book, it was very hard to not ask at least some of the questions that the book had posed in the context of urban social science. And I think it, actually for me, it had two other impacts. One was there's a component of a paradigm shifting work that doesn't just force you to ask different questions, but makes it very hard for you to imagine the thing you're studying outside of the things, outside of the theory, outside of the model it posits. And that happened to me. I spent a lot of time, I still do, trying to imagine a completely alternative theory of what's happening in cities that does not take into account at all what's mentioned in the two disadvantage. I just can't do it. I've tried, man. I've tried everything, institutions, Max Weber, culture, Hegel, and so it just has not been possible. You know, all of the stories, even if they seemed interesting, seemed fundamentally flawed because they failed to take into account some aspect of what was mentioned in the book. So to me, that's really the mark of a true classic. Actually, the second thing it did is, as I was making the transition from the sociology of knowledge to urban, you know, I'd spent a lot of time going to talks and attending and reading papers by, you know, labor economists and demographers, God bless them, that were primarily concerned with, you know, is the coefficient 0.05 or is it 0.07? And, you know, the fall from Hegel to a 0.02 difference in a coefficient was rough. And I love math, you know. I was like, well, how could it be so far? But Bill, you know, the book was imaginative, it was theoretical, it had substantial components, it even had policy implications, it was a very soft landing. So thank you, Bill. What I want to talk about is an aspect of the book. I'm going to use an example and then advance a set of ideas that shows us, I think, a lot of what the promise of the book is and was very clearly early on, and the new areas for sort of where do we go for the next 25 years based on some of the ideas in the book. One of the things I liked about the book, and it's a rare attribute, that it had substantive theory, it had a substantive model about what happened in cities, the industrialization, et cetera. We've already talked about it multiple times. But separate from that substantive story, it also had a theoretical model about what happens to people in neighborhoods, about the fact that, for example, people tend to orient their lives around those of others in their neighborhood, was an important assumption, about the fact that in certain kinds of conditions, you can become socially isolated from other peers, about the fact that this social isolation would have an impact on your self-understanding and your opportunities for the future. That was actually a strictly theoretical model. I think it was an important component of the book. And of course, it had a huge impact on policy. I mean, we just heard an instance in how we think about MTO, of course. Even today, you know, I think of the Harlem Children's Zone, for example, as an instantiation of the place-based orientation of the truly disadvantaged. And I'd actually like to take the Harlem Children's Zone as a starting point for a couple of ideas I'd like to offer as our place for discussion. And by the way, I'm still a little bit in culture shock. When I was here in graduate school, we used to have two models for presentations. One, which we call the sociology model, wherein the presenter would speak and then the questions would come. And the other one we call the economist model, where the presenter would start and then the conversation would continue, usually after the first and second slides. After a few years at a certain Midwestern institution, I've come to call those the Harvard model and the Chicago model. I've also come to appreciate how polite the economists at Harvard are. It's all so nice. Anyway, so all this to say, feel free to interrupt. I don't mind. I'm used to a highly interactive dynamic. So anyway, the Harlem Children's Zone, you've already heard about it. It's basically a model in which Jeffrey Canada and others are trying to, in a zone, in a specially contiguous area, in a neighborhood, take what they consider disadvantaged children from the cradle to college. Right, and the idea is from the time the mother is actually pregnant with the child, you provide support services for the family, and you basically, it's not hand-holding, but you basically oversee and provide supports for the child until the time they're in and through college. And the idea is that this package of services is provided within the zone. So any child in that space, any child in that zone is eligible for the services provided by the baby college, as we'll recall. This will be the mothers, while they're pregnant, basically learn about child rearing and parenting. The charter school, of course, if you're in the zone, you get to get in. The after-school programs, if you're in the school, you get to participate, and so on. It also has a longevity component, meaning that over time, as new services get built, they get built within the zone so that children in the zone can participate. As you know, it's been an extremely popular model. Back in 2008, when President Obama's campaign included poverty as part of its platform, the Promised Neighborhoods, which were inspired by the Harlem Children's and were a major part of the initiative. There were promises of many billions of dollars. It's not a political statement. There were promises of many billions of dollars to be spent on Promised Neighborhoods. That became more like 40 million, and I'm sure others here can correct me if those numbers are off. But certainly the idea was take this model, which is basically a spatial concentration model, address the issues in the area and replicate it across the country. I think a really nice way of thinking about both the contributions that the tool of disadvantage pose for us and where we go from here has to do with, does that work, right? Using that sort of policy, experiment is a strong word, particularly in this context, but that's policy idea and extrapolating theoretically from it. So for those of you who don't know, my first book was based on fieldwork here in Boston, I've done fieldwork in New York, and I've done fieldwork in Chicago. And so some of what you're going to hear is based on different kinds of fieldwork experiences in different kinds of cities. Now suppose you try to take the Harlem Children's Zone and put it in a very different kind of city. The zone, by the way, and this is a big part of the narrative, is a 100 block area. This is a sort of big part of the story. This is part of the big impactful number that says, hey, you can make a real serious impact, as opposed to just addressing a small number of people. If you've been in New York, you'll know that in New York City, blocks are about 20 to a mile. Okay, which means that the 20 block area is actually about the 100 block area, excuse me, of the Harlem Children's Zone is actually about a square mile. Now, because this is Harlem, the population density in that area is just under 60,000 per square mile. That means that if you are going to have a zone-based program that's only a square mile, you can still address and cover and service thousands of families who need the services you're providing, because this is Harlem, New York City. In addition, if you've been in Harlem, you walk down 125th, you know that one of the most accessible places is actually New York, or anywhere, is actually Harlem. There's on the west side, the A, B, C, D, one on the nine lines, the 4, 5, 6 on the east side, and there are multiple crosstown buses, and so on. What does this mean? That means that if I'm a poor family, if I'm a poor mother, a poor father living anywhere in Harlem, it's actually quite easy for me to reach the Harlem Children's Zone. I can walk, right? Most of the time I can walk within 20 minutes, and if I can't, I just take either the crosstown bus or one of the subway lines. It's actually quite easy, a highly accessible place. This is what happens when you have 60,000 people, or just under that, actually, per square mile. Now, suppose you try that in another, very different kinds of city. A city that a few of us know quite well is the city of Chicago. If you take all of the African-American high-poverty neighborhoods in New York, the population density is about 52,000 per square mile. In Chicago, it's about 12,000 per square mile. same neighborhoods, right? If you put this kind of entity in Chicago, it's very difficult to imagine a similar kind of scenario reaching that many people that easily. Particularly if you put it in the poor neighborhoods that, as Bill and others pointed out, were because of the industrialization, depopulated as a result of the departure from the middle class. Right? You drive around, you wrote about it in the book, you drive around Woodlawn, you drive around many of the neighborhoods, Garfield, empty lot after empty lot. Loic has written about it, you've written about it, empty lot after empty lot after empty lot. What happens is that same idea actually doesn't really work that well. If you take a different kind of, take Detroit, which is one of our, right, when everybody talked about promised neighborhoods and other kinds of cities, everybody thought about Detroit. In Detroit, again, the African-American predominantly poor neighborhoods are between 8 and 10,000 per square mile. A very different kind of scenario. What's more, if you look at within city population densities, right, because cities are their own ecosystems, in New York City, the poorest neighborhoods in the city are those with the highest population density within the city. Okay, so in other words, in New York, the poor neighborhoods are not isolated, right? They're not, it's not social isolation, it's overcrowding. It's overcrowding, unaffordable rents, and ability to access services because the waiting lists for childcare centers and other things are miles long. In New York, in Chicago, of course, we all know the story. It's actually social isolation. It's deinstitutionalization, it's depopulation. You can't find any, and nobody can hear you scream, right? That's sort of the model. If you look at organizational density, instead of population density, the story is actually very, very similar. In New York, the poorest neighborhoods have the highest density of both people and establishments and institutions. Go to New York, every other corner has a bodega, a laundry store, a convenience store. I'm not talking about quality, that's a separate conversation. It's an important one. In Chicago, the poorest neighborhoods are the ones in the city that have nothing. No people, no organizations, no establishments, no nothing. So if you think about, well, how do we transfer? Now, these are just Rust Belt cities. Go west. Go to LA. Go to Oakland. Go to Tucson. Go to Albuquerque. How would you even envision creating a zone? It's actually quite easy to imagine that the most sensible kind of zone might be actually kind of putting the establishments on the highways, on the cross. Did you say 2 minutes? At the intersections of highways. And finally, two more points. There's a separate set of issues which has to do with the broader, so that's density, organizational density. So one of the things I'd like to offer is, well, what happens if we start thinking in terms of densities of people and organizations? Depopulation as an alternative to concentration, right? The idea of concentration of poverty was, of course, accurate. But in a sense, that concentration that Bill theorized resulted from depopulation. So I wonder if a depopulation model might tell us something that's interesting from both theoretical and policy perspective that a concentration model doesn't. The second quick point I'll make has to do with convergence and divergence. And one of the things I've been very concerned with has been whether over the 1980s, 90s, and 2000s, poor neighborhoods across cities have become more and more similar to each other or more and more different from each other. I've started doing some working on with a graduate student on this, and I don't have any slides for you today, but there are a couple of pictures that are quite interesting. With respect to the things that Bill theorized, for example, the proportion of men working in manufacturing jobs, there's been increased convergence. Across the board, the slope looks like that. But remember, between 1997 and 2012, several things have happened. The proportion of Latinos migrating to city and migrating differentially across the country has exploded, right? Cities in the South and Southwest have increased dramatically in populations, especially dramatically in Latino populations. In fact, today, it is not African Americans, but Latino who constitute the largest minority group in the majority of American cities, okay? Second, the passage of the Personal Responsibility and Work Opportunity Act of 1996. A major impact of the act was taking AFDC at the time, which is a federal program, federally controlled, federally mandated, and it's, of course, allocating block grants and responsibilities to the states. More state responsibility, more divergence, more differential experiences across cities, in different kinds of cities, in the opportunities available to the poor. And finally, I'll just mention also the collapse of the credit markets and the ensuing total collapse of the real estate market. In cities that had strong institutional structures, had been growing for a long time, in which crowding, crowding and similar kinds of problems were the issue, cities like New York, yeah, of course it hurt everybody, but they basically bounced back pretty effectively. Rents are rising in New York already. They've been rising. Cities like Las Vegas that had ridden the housing boom very, very rapidly collapsed even more painfully. And so you can imagine that the differences in the experiences of poverty across these two kinds of cities will diverge over time. I'll just wrap up with that idea with saying that I think a second sort of set of issues that the book points us to, and that thinking anew about these sets of issues, is to what extent are we having similar, i.e. increasingly converging, as opposed to diverging experiences of neighborhood poverty, of spatial poverty across cities. With that, I'll thank you very much, and I'll turn it over to the next speaker.
Thank you, Mario. And our last speaker on the panel is Sudhir Venkatesh, who is professor of sociology at Columbia. I have another connection here. So Sudhir got his PhD from the University of Chicago. I'm guessing, what, mid to late 90s?
A long time ago.
Yeah. He's no longer young. No, he is. Under Bill, worked with Bill, and pleasure to introduce Sudhir.
I hope that after his talk, Mario will give us a lesson in time management. I don't know how he gets all this stuff done, everything that he does, but it's amazing. I want to begin with a very profound question, perhaps the most profound question I can see being asked today, and that is, what do you call a student who decides to, or who ends up beating Bill Wilson in a game of golf? Truly disadvantaged. Never happened to me, of course. I also want to just thank Bill for a crazy turn in my life that was inspired by him, and that I want to use to begin the talk today. And that is that about 2.5 years ago, I got called by the FBI director, Director Mueller, to come work for them. So I took a leave from Columbia, and it was an extraordinary experience trying to see if I could make knowledge useful in the policy realm. And I don't think I would have been inspired to do something like that had I not spent a lot of time with Bill on golf courses and other places, listening to the challenges that he had put to his graduate students and trying to the moral urgency, if you will, of some of this work. So. Thank you, Bill, for that inspiration. And I want to begin with a very simple question that keeps coming up at the FBI, and that the best way I can do it is to say that I'll call it my ethnography there. I'm calling the money ball at the FBI. They find themselves in situations that are very simple, and here's one. There's a wiretap, and a young man is being told by his mother in a very poor neighborhood in the South that he has to go out and sell more drugs than he is doing currently. That the mother's boyfriend has been taken to jail. There's a loss of income in the home. And this young man who's 16 years old is going to have to step up his game a little bit and take a greater role in the household, be a man, as it were. The transcript of the wiretap comes across and is researched by two different, is read by two different people at the agency. On the one hand, it's read by a group of very well-trained economists, often the people who have deep quantitative thinking, and they essentially say that this is very unlikely that this young man will actually stay on the street. It's not really worth our time. We can ignore it. It's noise, really. Then there are the salty cops. After 20 years on the force, they come and decide to work for the FBI. And they say, you know what? You guys, you economists don't know a thing. Spend 20 years, and then you'll know how to see real data. I think this is really important. We think this is really important. And this is worth our going in, because this is the sign of a young man who's going to be a drug kingpin. And in that discrepancy of seeing, I want to start this talk because I think it poses this question about what do we see when we look at neighborhoods? What counts as structure? Because as we see data, we find that we have great difficulties, I think, figuring out exactly how to take a measure of a neighborhood, take stock of a neighborhood, and what are those kinds of structures that actually motivate us to act. And in this case, there are several choices that these FBI agents could make. They could go in with a very expensive, hundreds of thousands of dollar investigation. They could alert a local police officer who is now working with the FBI to intervene in some soft way. They could alert a member of the community and so on. There's a choice about policing. And for somebody who's been studying street gangs for a very long time and criminals in the underground economy, this was an eye-opening experience for me in thinking about neighborhood structure, because when we think about social dislocations, apart from theorizing the lack of legitimacy of the police, we often don't think about what the police actually do, what the state actually does in a neighborhood. And I want to talk, and I want to use that as to say that that is part of the structure of the neighborhood that that we should be thinking about. I don't know if there's an advance. I want to begin by just taking a quote from Greg Duncan. Greg is such a nice guy, it's hard not to pick on him. It's a very simple phrase. Gautreaux cut the Gautreaux program he's talking about. Gautreaux cut these mean neighborhood poverty rates by more than a half to 20%. As of the late 1990s, both the mothers and the children were living in communities with poverty rates that were similar to those of their placement addresses, about 18% for both. Excuse me. The sustained residential successes of families moving in conjunction with the Gautreaux program is indeed striking, and just my emphasis on striking. This, I think, is a way in which we conventionally think about structure. Right? It is a way we think about what is meaningful for a family. Right? It's obviously relative, of course, because I imagine if many people in this room had to move into a 25 or 28% poverty tract, it would be not an improvement. So it's always a relative move. But this, I think, is a kind of a distance notion of structure if we want to understand what it means for how the point of view of families who are moving into this neighborhood of 20% poverty. What will their everyday experience be? And I think I want to start figuring out how to, in taking a look at what we've learned from the truly disadvantaged, what different kinds of structures do we need to be thinking about in neighborhoods to answer this kind of question? And really, I think Rob has a wonderful statement in his new book, which is a fascinating book, in which he says, neighborhoods are socially productive, important determinants of the quantity and quality of human behavior in their own right. So the question really for me is, as an ethnographer, is what kinds of neighborhood attributes do we really need to know about? For a very long time, I think we have had a kind of ecological view of a neighborhood, but ecological in one way that I think Rob is doing a lot to transform. That change when we think about neighborhoods changing, because people aren't coming into static neighborhoods, they're making decisions in neighborhoods that are themselves changing, are a function of macroeconomic institutions. We often measure change by demographic variables, and then we read off individual experience of these from these ecological conditions. And I think we're starting to move to, in a slightly different way, especially from the work that Mario, his last book, which is terrific, is an institutional view in which we're looking at the kinds of structural aspects of neighborhoods that facilitate action. And the two questions that are critical for me as an ethnographer are, what are the visions of the future that inform assessment and behavior on the part of families? Because if we don't know where they're trying to go, we're not really sure how they're trying to act, that they're trying to reach some goal. And second, how do these local contexts of action change over time, inform people's behavior? So that people respond to these kinds of structured practices in neighborhoods that generate these expectations and norms, et cetera. So another way of thinking about this question of structure is, what are the predominant structured ways in which people act in the context of social dislocations that impact their everyday life locally? Some influences could be ecological. So in the case of crime, in the case of gun violence, et cetera, what actually happens in these areas? I want to just use two brief examples to set up the next part of this talk, which is, imagine there's two incidents of gun violence that involve two young people and their families. It could be over a street gang, it could be because one person looked at another person funny. I mean, it could be tragic for a number of reasons. And let's say we follow and see what happens as almost in a scripted way to see how what the response is in a community. So perhaps, as often is the case, there's a police officer that's intervening, maybe there's somebody in the community, maybe it's a member of a clergy that starts to intervene. You start seeing people start to surround the youth and his or her family. Maybe there's another mediator who lends their assistance, a high school principal, et cetera. And as often happens, in terms of watching these kinds of events, you'll see that the family members start aligning themselves with one of the persons in the community, a stakeholder, often a member of the clergy, who tells them, you know, let me mediate, let me give you information, let me try to resolve the situation, mediate the disputes of these youth, et cetera. The police are still very much involved. Now, here's where a situation might change. On the one hand, imagine that the police start to play a far more distant role, as it were. And instead, you have a situation in which there's a microecology in which all of the community-based entities and these families surround themselves with the youth. So in this case, let's say it's two gang leaders and a clergy member who are involved in the mediation. It's a gang-related shooting. The gang agreed not to sell drugs in some facility, in like a park, et cetera. And their vision of the future and the mediators is that they have to accept the gangs. They're never going to get rid of them, so they try to modify their behavior. That's a common scenario that often occurs. This could go in a very different way, and the police are really not that involved. This could go in a very different way, which is the youth sit at a church with the clergy member who's acting on behalf of all these people, with the police officer, and the outcome is that there's no fighting for 30 days. The two youth agree to be monitored by this clergy member of the clergy. They give up their guns, or the police officer says, you know, give up your guns or you're going to go to jail. Maybe there's a little bit of a threat. And the vision of the future is, let's really just reduce the violence. Countless of incidents like these occur every day in neighborhoods. And the question I want to pose is, what can we do with situations like this? What kind of structure can this tell us that can complement the kind of structure that we usually adopt when we think about the ecology of neighborhoods? This is what I've been doing in two communities in Chicago, Roseland and West Pullman. I did this a very long time ago in 2005, where I just looked at all of the Chicago police data in terms of their records of any incidents that had a gun that was involved, any police report. And the people in the community that I was working with, we tried to track down as many of them to see how they were mediated. Is that me? We tried to see how they were mediated. And then we went back when I was with the Bureau to try and figure out what changed after time. So in 2011, the same thing, all official police records. And then you just go and track down with informants in the neighborhood following each incident. We've got about 75% of them. Okay, I'm going to go really quick. This is a very, very poor community on the south side of the city. These were 32 incidents in the month of July in which we tracked in 2005. This was 2011. Incidents in which there was a gun recorded by the police. That's an extraordinary sharp escalation in violence in which there's more guns in the neighborhood, perhaps. There's maybe a rise in the perception of individuals that guns are legitimate, and so on and so forth. We can think of many explanations for why this might have occurred. The interesting thing is, when you start tracking down what happens in mediation, you see that on the left is 2005, on the right is 2011. You see that the role of community-based organizations in the community starts to increase. They start to take a greater role in what happens. It could be a clergy, and it could be an assistant school principal, et cetera. But in some way, the state is starting to be marginalized from this community. They're starting to have a far lower role in playing in terms of the mediation, and some community-based organization is working with them. I'm sorry, I'm just going to go very quickly here. So this is when a church was involved. It's in 2011. 42% of the time in the Roseland community, you have a member of the clergy. 58% of the time in West Pullman. And so, again, asking this question, what are the structured fields of action, barring Flickstein's term, for gun-related violence in a 28.5% poverty rate neighborhood? And then you can start to build up your sense of structure in a context of rapidly rising gun use, where community-based organizations are taking an increased role, where the state seems to be altering its presence, where religious organizations are asserting their role, et cetera. so that the ecology or the kind of ecological portrait of this neighborhood is driven by an emergent understanding of how people are working in relationship with each other, so that the relationships marry the kind of data that we can get from a demographic sense to build up our portrait of this place. So I'm going to conclude here with what happened over time in this neighborhood from 2005 to 2012 as it became inundated with gun violence. If you looked at mediation in 2012, you started to see a state that was collaborative, that the red line really is just showing that all of these actors were working together. The police were in the neighborhood, working kind of informally, working formally as well, working with members of the clergy, with mediators. A community-based organization might direct a dispute resolution. But because the police were there, they could easily help channel an individual into a community-based organization. There was a link to a service provision, what Irving Spergel might call the social work school of dispute resolution, a very integrative model. It starts to change as more and more violence gets into this neighborhood. All of a sudden, you see the mediated state in which when the police are inside the circle, they start becoming outside. If anyone's seen this film, The Interrupters, by Steve James, if you know the work of the Chicago ceasefire, not David Kennedy's ceasefire, you start to see that the police grow very distant. And in fact, that's one of their pillars, is that they don't work with the police, they can't work with the police, et cetera. The state's role starts to shift as it no longer becomes involved in some of these mediations. You start to see what Bill calls social isolation from the mainstream in these fields of action. Finally, there is the besieged state, in which you'll see the great reports in the media in which the state asserts its authority, the rate of arrest will increase, these different people are working in different areas, they're not working with each other, and individuals start to speak as though choices are mutually exclusive. Either you work with the police or you don't work with the police. It becomes very antagonistic. So this is the kind of structure, I think, that an ethnographer would try to complement with those looking at in an ecological sense by trying to figure out, well, yes, there's a 20% poverty rate, 30%, 40%, whatever it happens to be, but a family that comes in is faced with a number of choices, and depending on the ways in which these relationships are aligned, they might choose to act in a particular way. So I just put that up there because I think, in addition to the Bill's question, you know, is this a socially isolated neighborhood in which these institutions are kind of tossed? We could take Rob's question, which I think has always been the fascinating question when you're looking at dislocation. Would we call these kinds of situations collectively efficacious? Which one would have to hold? If the police are not involved and we're thinking about an interrupter model, is that a collectively efficacious neighborhood? Or do you need the presence of the mainstream? Finally, the work of Flickstein and McAdam here, I think, is really interesting in moving us in a direction of trying to link ecologies that give us a snapshot of neighborhoods over time or in a point of time to fields of action in terms of what is it like for individuals and how they might work. So that the context for these kinds of social order maintenance is ever changing, and I think we could do a better job in the next few years of trying to understand how these institutions are acting. The family experience of disadvantage is dependent on these local fields of action. So if you're moving into a neighborhood in which there's a besieged state, or you're moving into a neighborhood in which there's a collaborative environment, it's going to really change your experience, your willingness to use the police, et cetera. Demographic indicators, as I've said, or ratios are helpful, but only partially. And I think we need to really work on looking at ecology as a function of the organizations and informal relations, as Mario and Nicole Marwell and others have done. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sudhir. We got started a little bit late, so I think we still have time for some questions. Yeah, about 10 minutes for questions.
Well, first I want to thank all the presenters. This is just so much to react to. It's just a feast. And I'll just pick on one point, and maybe Mario can answer and others can jump in. Let's imagine that every city was like New York City, that you don't encounter this problem of the differential ecologies. I still see that the main problem of moving from the Harlem Children's Zone to having an impact nationally, is the problem of scale. Is in, simply in order to reproduce the children's, the Highlands children's zone, essentially you would need to plunk in tens of billions of dollars, and in a sense, it's, since it's politically not feasible, it's not going to happen. So in a sense, we are looking at difficulties that have to do with the differences in cities, but it's not going to happen for other reasons anyway.
Yeah, I completely agree. I mean, since I was cut short in time, you were just doing your job. I wasn't able to go into as much detail as I wanted, but right, one of the things that makes Harlem unique is, well, first, it's got a superstar fundraiser in Jeffrey, Canada. It's in New York, you know. I don't think it'd be just as easy to go out and even get millions of dollars to support an initiative in Bushwick or in, you know, whatever, as it is in Harlem. I mean, there's a Harlem Renaissance, it has a particular history. So I think the financial constraints of doing something like this, even in an all cities or like New York, I actually think are quite substantial. Frankly, even in New York, I mean, lots of poor children live in Harlem, but a majority of New York poor children do not live in Harlem, right? And so, I mean, part of the reason I wanted to bring this example to the fore is if you think about, and again, I'm not really interested in the politics of it, but if you think about where our policy imagination has been in alternatives, I mean, a lot of the conversation really in the 2000 election was about, you know, promised neighborhoods and choice neighborhoods. And, you know, where are we now? Where are the new ideas? And so part of what I was hoping to do with my talk is say, look, we need something else. We really need something else, and I haven't seen it.
I have one. Pat? Yeah, just one related point is, while I agree with the, you know, huge budgetary issues and the fact that we're not going to be expanding money for social programs and for education, other things, there is some very interesting work by my colleague Roland Fryer, in which, you know, he's done work evaluating the Harlem Children's Zone, in which he, using the same resources that already exist in neighborhoods and in public schools, imagine you try to find the strategies like in the Harlem Children's Zone, their charter school, other charter schools, other sorts of well-functioning social institutions, and imagine with the same budget going in to another public school system or set of neighborhoods and seeing if you can distill any lessons holding the budget constant from those sorts of things and actually try to improve them. And he's currently experimenting in Houston and Denver with some of those, and there are, you know, short run, some promising results that there may be these pilot programs that we're never going to fund at the level they do may tell us something about the way the school day operates, what extra services ought to be there that we could more effectively use our funding in other areas. And while I know that's sort of pie in the sky, I think there is some move in that direction.
Okay, I'll try to be very brief in introduction, but many things that you're talking about is of great interest to me. I was born in Harlem Hospital in 1934, the child of immigrants. There were six of us. My father spoke Dutch. That was his original language, Dutch, and then French, because my grandfather was a Frenchman on his side. My mother spoke English from the British colony, Trinidad, and six of us were born here. My youngest brother has two PhDs and three master's degrees, and he lives in Malibu, California. He's a psychologist and a psychoanalyst. My oldest brother graduated from high school at the age of 16, and then he died in the Air Force in 57 as a navigator and second lieutenant. So it's a long story to go into. I quit school at the age of 16. I've never regretted it. I was thoroughly bored and said I'd never go back in for the rest of my life. But I continued learning. I love reading. Without a high school diploma, I was selling Encyclopedia Britannica in the 1960s, became a sales manager for World Book Encyclopedia eventually. 7 years after I quit school, I was a real estate agent. I worked for 59 years at varied occupations. I've never had a jaw problem in my life. Since 1960, I've been very much involved in helping people. There's not a single person here in this audience that I would not help in any way if you needed some suggestion or help in whatever way, physical help or whatever. And so many people of varying complexions have helped me in my life. So I feel very gratified for that. I'm very lucky. I'll be 78 years old October 13th, and I have an overall better physical condition than the majority of Americans, regardless of age. In my early 40s, I used to run marathons, and I was able to run a mile in under 6 minutes. Exercise every day, 42 years regular. We learn at Gold's Gym. So, but helping people is part of my life. And people have helped me. I've been very lucky to work with people helping me. Many of them you don't even know. We wouldn't be here right now. I also participated in 9 election campaigns, not as a politician, but as a means of getting publicity. That includes mayor of New York City in 1969, mayor of Oakland, California in 1977, vice president of the United States in 1968, Congress 3 times, the first time in 1970 against Rangel, and I've spoken nationally and internationally. I was in France in 1968 for the May-June uprisings there, toured across Canada, spoke all over this country. I was at the March of Washington. I was an assistant of one of King's assistants. So anyway, what I'd like to say is this: why is it that we can't get a different perspective on this world and on this system? The greatest type of incarceration is mental incarceration. This country has about almost 2.5 million people physically incarcerated, but mental incarceration is the greatest type of incarceration in this country and the world, where they take over your mind. That's what the ruling classes do, and many people think they're educated, but they have been indoctrinated by the ruling classes. They do that for thousands of years. I'm a historian and a political scientist without a degree in either subject.
Thank you for that provocative statement. Right here, Patrick.
This is in response to Loic's comment. I think we should acknowledge the fact that in 2009 there were $800 billion set aside in the Recovery Act, a huge portion of which were going to they weren't named Promised Neighborhoods. You know, in terms of budget, we should forget about Promised Neighborhoods and Choice Neighborhoods because they're tiny and the scale is tiny, but when you look at the Recovery Act, now the key characteristic of the Recovery Act is that it's temporary. It's a 2-year program. But this was the biggest infusion of dollars at a scale grander than any other social program that has been implemented, you know, in decades. And this was going to enormous amounts of funds were going to every disadvantaged community across the country. I mean, the scale of the Recovery Act was just enormous, both in terms of geographic scale, in terms of dollar amounts. So I think, I don't know that the, you know, we can do this when kind of the forces align and there is momentum behind an administration and an idea. It may not come together frequently, but it has happened.
Just to bear on that, if you think about the scale of the kinds of policies and the amounts of money they're, you know, put into other things, I think I would agree. It's not out of the question there'll be some, you know, resurgence once the economy recovers. But I think in terms of the policies, I mean, I think one point I'd like to make is that it's kind of gotten bifurcated into the sort of people or place in terms of the implications, and I'd sort of be curious of, in terms of Bill's reactions to this, because the way it's been framed is that a lot of the big policies, and Larry put it this way as well, right, in the 1990s when a lot of the changes were being thought about, the way Bill's book was read was in a particular way in terms of improving the truly disadvantaged neighborhoods. And you kind of have two models, right? I mean, one is the Gautreaux/MTO, which is these are bad places, and therefore we need to get people out. I'm oversimplifying, of course, but that's one way to think about it. And the other way to think about it is more to renew what's already there, and that's sort of the Hope 6 mixed-income neighborhoods, trying to stabilize the neighborhood so people don't have to move out. Now, those are radically different ways of thinking about it. Sort of curious as to what Bill thinks in terms of what his book actually implied. I think it's been read as almost solely, well, they're so, quote, pathological that we need to destroy them. And I think, actually there's a third model, right, which is not MTO and it's not renew, but it's just kill them off, blow them off. I mean, seriously, those that don't know Chicago, Robert Taylor Holmes, which was the poster child for...
And don't provide anything in...
Yeah, where 30,000 or so people lived there. These were, you know, families with kids, histories. Cabrini Green, gone. Robert Taylor Holmes, gone. In my book, I have a photograph of former Robert Taylor Holmes. It's just a field. There is nothing there. There's nothing that it was replaced with. It simply was blown up, literally with dynamite, and people came on a Saturday morning one day and and watched it blow up. And it was sort of demonized and then destroyed. So there, I think there's big policy issues here in terms of what do we do? Do you destroy, do you move out, or do you renew? And I think we need creative solutions that bear on all of these, because I think voucher-based approaches are going to continue. The one thing I would say is that it does seem that we're a bit thinking about only one-way street, which is, well, let's give people vouchers to move out. You could also imagine housing policy changes that would give middle-class or upper-income people incentives to move into low-income neighborhoods, right? If you think about Bill's argument, theoretically, that's actually a mechanism that could work to stabilize low-income neighborhoods that doesn't really seem to be work. So I think there are creative ways to think about it. So,
well, sure.
Because I think all of us in some different ways, the MTO, my own work on the reproduction, sort of the persistence of poverty. You see these neighborhoods, right. These traps are hard to get out of. So I guess the question is, and I've thought about this hard, I'm not sure I have any easy answers either, but that is the question of the day.
Well, first of all, let me say, Pat, I'm really glad you raised this point about the stimulus package, which included $80 billion for lower-income people. So when people say Obama hasn't done anything for the poor, people like Cornel West and others, they don't know what the hell they're talking about. The problem is he hasn't really talked about it publicly. Okay, we don't have much time. Let me just respond to your point. On page 288 of the afterword, I state, the point to be emphasized is that I propose the creation of macroeconomic policy, labor market policy, and family policy to enable poor inner city families to develop the resources they needed to make their own mobility decisions and to remove the historic discriminatory obstacles that would curtail their social and geographic mobility. Given this comprehensive policy discussion, arguments that imply that this book explicitly underlines supports the deconcentration of public housing as a policy option, despite the obvious benefits that accrue to poor families that participate in the successful underlying programs involving housing vouchers and scattered site public housing, are, to put it mildly, displaced, unquote. In other words, I outline my policies that flow directly from my analysis and are not just restricted to moving people out of neighborhoods. That's important, but I say what we need. My extended discussion of policy options, which flows from my analysis of the social transformation of the inner city, highlights macroeconomic policy to generate economic growth in tight labor markets, fiscal and monetary policy to stimulate non-inflationary growth and increase the competitiveness of American goods on both the domestic and international markets, and a national labor market strategy to make the labor force, including the black labor force, more adaptable to changing economic opportunities. I also advocated a family allowance program, a child support assurance program, and a child care strategy, unquote.
Well, I think it's quarter up, and Bill had the last word. I think that's a good time to wrap it up. And thank you to the panel, and thanks for everyone coming. We'll see you again at 1 o'clock. 12:30.
So I thought the whole point was that, we had the stimulus.